So you take three images with your 45 millimeter perspective control lens, one on the left, in the middle, and on the right, by shifting only the lens, not the tripod, to combine them together. Just like this guy is doing in this video.
Set it all the way to the left or all the way to the right, and take your first shot.
So this is your result, and it's the equivalent in a field of view with a 28 millimeter lens. And now you say, why go to all this trouble and not just shoot the scene with a 28? Have one picture, get done with it. Well, the jury is still out on that one, but generally speaking, the middle of the image is not pushed further away, as is usually the case with wide-angle lenses. You get a few more pixels, and items at the edges are not elongated. They appear pretty much normal, even after conversion. Because the problem with wide-angle lenses is that at the edges you get a car that looks not only stretched out and elongated, but it also looks kind of flat, like it's a carton prop, you know, like it's made out of carton, two-dimensional. In some cases, actually, the flattening effect is so severe, like, look at the top of these flowers. It looks like a gigantic glass is stacked over the flowers, and the entire surface has the same height. It's like they're flattened from the top. And the trees kind of look like two-dimensional carton props. The same, let's say, with the woman in this image in the center. She looks like she is a carton prop. Doesn't look real. So that's where I come in running and I say, fisheye. Because with a fisheye, even at the edges, you have normal dimensions of the items. They're not distorted, and especially if they're a little further away from you, right? Because if they're close to you, they're going to inherit the whole spherical effect of the image. But if they're a little further away, they're not going to be elongated like they are with a wide-angle lens shot from the same exact point with a tripod. This guy over here, and I recommend that you watch this video by B&H, shoots weddings with fisheye lenses. Well, among the other lenses he uses. And depending on the angle of view and the distance and everything, he can get from realistic, slightly surrealistic results all the way to full-blown surrealistic, depending on what he wants to do. But it's besides the point for this video. I just needed that I had to mention these examples. Let's go back to our perspective control thing. 28 millimeters. I want more, you say. I want wider. 28 is nothing. I can shoot that with a 28 lens. So you turn your head to the left, your head, not the camera, to the left. What do you see? This is what you see. All of a sudden the road is not parallel, it goes that way. You never noticed it before. Because you say, well, the road is just straight in front of me, it's completely parallel. That's because your field of view of the human eye is huge. It's the biggest fisheye you ever seen. Almost 180 degrees. And you're looking in the middle, the brain captures the entire scene and translates it as a completely parallel road. The brain is genius in doing that. But if you isolate your view with your eyes only to the left side, this is what you're going to see, and you never noticed it before, did you? That's why I say people do not know what they see. And then you turn your head in the middle, and this is what you see, and that is the best thing you can expect from Photoshop afterwards. The image to the left, indeed, the road goes that way up. And it is realistic, you just never noticed it before, because your brain corrects it. That's the perspective, that's the actual perspective. The middle is fine, and the one on the right goes up the other way. And then you complain, and you say, well, the road is just completely horizontal. Because we look outside the window, and we say, oh yeah, this road is completely parallel, straight, doesn't go that way or the other way, because our brain corrects it, it's very wide. But if we isolate our view, put a piece of carton on each side of your head, you're gonna see now that your perspective changed. Now the road is not parallel anymore. It's only parallel in the middle. It's not parallel when you shift, when you just turn your head left or right and you isolate the other views. So then Photoshop comes and says, wait a second, I have another method of combining the images, which is called the perspective method. And this is what you're gonna get. And you say, okay, the road now appears straight, but I'm losing part of the picture. And Photoshop is going to tell you, yeah, because that was your middle picture, remember? This was your middle picture. And you say, ah. The other picture, when you turned the tripod to the left, you changed the perspective, and obviously the truck was inside, the blue truck. That was your middle picture, remember? And now you got another problem. The car is elongated now. But you know. So my wide angle lens was not defective. That's the perspective, the viewing perspective. So the next time that you are assuming that you're actually seeing the scene, maybe you're not. Maybe you're not really seeing the scene and you get unpredictable photographs. Why do I see like this? Why is the road all the way not parallel? Why is it, does it go diagonally? Well, because the yellow car is closer to you than the red car. But duh, you know. So now you're gonna say, this is pretty much it. That's the limit of full frame. The 45 millimeter lens, the tripod staring in the middle, and I just shift the lens and that's it. I cannot take anything wider without any distortion. Well, of course you can. Take your tripod and go to the next house, right next to it, and do the same. And then the next house and the next house, and you're gonna stitch them all together into a really long picture, but you're not gonna be happy because the perspective will be the one of a guy who walks down the street and always looks across the street. You will never be happy because a photograph is not supposed to be what you see. A photograph is a composition that you make inside a frame. If we were supposed to photograph what we actually see, then all of our photographs would be taken with two fisheye lenses corrected by a human brain, because this is what we actually see. Just like in music, a composition can be comprised of a lot of instruments, or only two instruments, or only one instrument. Because somebody sees this picture and says, oh, that's nice, I'm gonna go take forest pictures too. And he goes to the forest and comes back with this. Why photograph one tree when you can just plug them all in, right? An example is that this scene, for example, that the guy shot with the iPhone 11, it is a wide-angle perspective, and that is the reason for the wide-angle lens, the perspective. But he kept it to one subject. So for all intents and purposes, this is a very good image. And this is also a very good image. It's a wider perspective, the main subject is one. Unfortunately, some photographers think that since they have a wide-angle lens, they have to, you know, sorry honey, it's a wide-angle lens, I'm gonna have to invite more girls to join in. So my general recommendation is that in your composition, choose the instruments that are relevant to your subject inside the frame. Try to exclude the rest. Let's say you're writing an essay in college. The topic of the essay, the subject, is a woman cooking. So why did you start talking about microwave ovens all of a sudden? The professor is going to tell you this paragraph is out of topic, out of subject. So the next time you're photographing a woman cooking, consider something like this. You don't need to photograph the entire kitchen. If you want the ingredients and everything, limit your picture, limit your frame to only the instruments of your composition, the same way one would do with music. What are my instruments? The vegetables, utensils, and the woman. That's it. That's what I'm gonna photograph. I don't need the cabinets, I don't need the microwave, I don't need the refrigerator, I don't need the end of the room. A composition, ideally, is comprised of only the instruments that you need, the reason that you're there to take the picture. It's just like musical composition. Somebody orders you a piece for piano and flute. So you write the piece for piano and flute, and then you say, why don't I just throw in 10 violins in the background? Nobody does that. Everything that does not belong to the composition is useless. It's disturbing. And I wish there was an easy way to actually remove all of the stuff that sometimes get in the frame. Atelier, did I help a little bit? Tell me I helped even a little bit. And Sebastian G with the M discs. I got it 2 years ago. I'm just not sure about future compatibility. I'm always insecure about that, especially the file formats and all that stuff. And that's why I say print, and print a lot of 5x7s. They're cheap, and they usually outlast everything. I almost forgot. Thomas, since you're interested in timber, every year this season we're getting this green substance on top of the bark of the trees. I don't know what it is. At any rate, it makes for an interesting woodland composition, because you don't have only your primary color now, you also have a secondary. I will talk about that in the next video. Thomas Erickson, my packet of skills is that I'm bad at everything I do. You are being too hard on yourself. If you were really bad at everything you do, you would not be in Sweden. You would be running for office in California. There's your problem over here, too much gear. We have an expression here, big hat, no cattle. The more gear you have, the less pictures you're gonna take. Thanks a lot, bye.